Morning, everyone. It's good to have everyone here to watch the service today, and we hope everyone's having a safe holiday and didn't get blown up by fireworks. We're just happy you'd be able to watch. If you got any questions about our service, no instruments with our music, baptism, or why we take the Lord's Supper every Sunday, call one of the elders or ministers, Larry or Jeremy, and we'll be glad to talk to you about that if you need to have a question. Any other help, if you need it, just let us know, and we'll be glad to help you. It's been a busy week. Chase Kraft passed away this week. It's Vicky's son. Benny Moore passed away this week. Services were held this week, and it's just been a sad week for the members here at Johnson. We need to remember those that's been in the hospital. James Allen has been in the hospital, and Charles Couch is awaiting surgery. There's several things happening. Let the congregation know that we've been supporting a young man in the Bear Valley Preacher School. They had a baby, I think, last July, and gonna have another one this July. So they've got a baby coming pretty quick. This month, we started supporting two more young men in Preacher School at Bear Valley. Tony Orleano, who grew up in Springdale, he attends Mount Comfort. Luke Skelton grew up in Springdale, attended Cave Springs. In the last few years, he's attended the RFCs at Mount Comfort. So that's three young men we're supporting at Bear Valley in Denver, Colorado. So you all have a part in that. Also, Terry checked with Jesus in Honduras. We sent them money for food. He still has enough food for a little while. He bought enough food for 100 families for a month. So he'll let us know when he needs more money for food, and y'all have a big part in feeding all these families in Honduras. They're having the same problem we do with the virus, but they're only allowed out once a week, except Jesus. He's got special permission from the government to get out and buy food and deliver food. So he's got special privileges that most people don't have. So they're kind of confined to their homes. We got several that have lost loved ones. Geneva Montgomery recently, Ashley Martin has lost her grandmother. Several has been sick. Hudson Mayhew will be having surgery soon. I think the 9th of July, having his tonsils out. It's not a big deal, but it's surgery. Anytime you have surgery, everybody's concerned about it. James Allen is home from the hospital and doing better. Still continuing to remember him. Charles Couch is going to have surgery. I think they put his off till September. So we need to remember Charles and upcoming surgery he's going to have. There's several others. Terry's nephew is waiting on a kidney transplant. Henry Hickman, I think Lisa's uncle. Lisa Lewis's uncle is waiting for a kidney transplant, and he's having some kidney problems. Justin Kavanaugh is having back surgery soon, real soon, maybe next week. They're just kind of working him in. He's got some back problems and is going to be confined at home for about 6 weeks, I think. So we need to remember all of our sick. I say we have a lot of sick and a lot of problems this week with the congregation here. We need to remember to read our Bibles. We've got this week it's Romans 13:2 through 2 Corinthians 3. So if you're like me, you may be a little behind, but we can get caught up. So let's remember to read our Bibles. Everyone be sure to check Facebook this week or your bulletin. There's some questions the elders would like to know about you coming back if we had services. We're still concerned about the number of cases of virus showing up every day. It's not decreasing any. We would like to be back to services, but we're just waiting on that to develop, see what happens. So if you would call the office and let us know how you feel about this. And we're just being cautious about opening up the building to different people. So let us know how you feel about that. I say we're just glad to have you here today and just thankful for you watching.
Good morning. Will you bow with me as we pray? Heavenly Father, we have so much turmoil in our country and so many things on our minds to ask for your help. The COVID virus and all of the deaths that it caused in our country and around the world. Pray that you would help us through that. Be with our first responders. Help them and keep them safe. The things that are going on in the Black community now, we have to stop and ask ourselves, have I done enough? Have we done enough? Honestly, we have to think about that. We ask Heavenly Father that you would help us to look into our hearts and find ways that we can help the Black community and ultimately ourselves and our souls to be better neighbors and friends than we have been. We thank you for all our many blessings, and we are so blessed in the country, and we bow before you and ask all this in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. The scripture reading this morning is 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 12. Finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another, love as brothers, be tender-hearted, be courteous, not returning evil for evil or violent for violent, but on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you were called to do this, that you may inherit a blessing. For he who would love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil.
We are so glad that you could join us today for our worship service at the Johnson Church of Christ. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. Last week, we started looking at some thoughts from 1 Peter chapter 3. Peter says there that we could learn to love life and see good days. He asked the question, and the question is, yes, I would like to learn to love life and see good days. That is so exciting, in fact, captivating. To have even the thought that we could love life and see good days. You know, because really, there hadn't been a whole lot of good days in this old world here lately. But that's what Peter is trying to tell us. Look, it doesn't matter about the world around you. The things that he has to tell us here are some wonderful, powerful, powerful things that can help us to love life, see good days, no matter what this world is doing, no matter what's happening around us. It's what is happening in us that makes the difference. We looked last week, and the first thing that Peter started off with is he said, if you want to love life and see good days, you've got to learn to cherish your friends and your family. In verse 8, he said, finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another, love as brothers, be tender-hearted, and be courteous. And you know yourself that one of the things that can destroy our happiness is broken relationships. Whether it's a broken relationship with the family, whether it's a broken relationship with our friends, whether it's a broken relationship certainly with God, there's no way that we can find happiness with a broken relationship with God. So Peter starts where at a really good place. Cherish your friends and your family. Work on your relationships. But now, this week, you know, you've heard the old saying, keep your friends close and keep your enemies even closer. Well, Peter says something like that. He says, if you want to love life and see good days, you've got to confront your foes. Not everybody's going to love you, people. You are going to have some enemies, and your greatest enemy, mankind's greatest enemy, is sin and evil and the devil. So Peter makes a real good point here. You're going to have to learn how to confront evil, how to handle evil in your life, because it will destroy you. Satan is doing his best to destroy you. He does not want you to go to heaven. In fact, he will do anything, any deceitful thing, tell you any lie, so that he can try to steer you on a path that will lead to destruction. And brother, he can do it too. Just ask the prodigal son. Oh, Satan promised him the world. And you remember where that led to. The prodigal son being in a hog pen somewhere. And that's exactly what Satan wanted. So how do we confront our foes? Well, Peter starts here in verse 9 by saying, not returning evil for evil or insult for insult. Someone has said there are three levels of living. The first level is returning evil for good, and that's satanic. The second level is returning evil for evil, and that's human. The third level is returning good for evil, and that's divine. The first level is unnatural. The second level is natural. The third level is spiritual. You know, I've heard people say, man, I'll get even with him if it's the last thing I do in this world. And I'm thinking to myself, partner, you don't know what you're saying. Because, look, if someone is down here with evil in their life and doing evil to you, and you're up here as a Christian on this level, and you want to get even, you're not going to bring him up. So what? It brings you down. So trying to get even is one of the worst mistakes that you could possibly make in this life. It will always bring you down. Kind of like the woman who went to the doctor. And the doctor ran some tests. And after he had run the test, he came in and he said, ma'am, he said, I've got some bad news. She said, oh, doctor, what is it? He said, I hate to tell you, but he said, you've got rabies. And she said, rabies? She said, bring me a pen and some paper quickly. And the doctor said, no, wait a minute. It's serious, but we can treat this. You're not going to die. You don't have to make out your will right now. And she said, well, doctor, I don't want to make out my will. I want to make a list of the people I want to bite. I don't think that was a very Christian idea to you. Don't try to get even. And then the next thing that Peter says here in verse 10 is he says, do not repeat evil. Let him who means to love life and see good days refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking guile. If you want to make a good day good, watch your words. If you want to make a good day go bad quick, let your tongue loose. Listen to what the wise man Solomon said in Proverbs 21, verse 23. He said, he who guards his mouth and his tongue guards his soul from troubles. And here's what the psalmist David said in Psalm 141, verse 3. Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Many beautiful occasions have been ruined with some harsh and hurtful and evil words. An old saying is, many things have been opened by mistake, but none of them more frequently than the mouth. Man, is that ever true? And then Peter in verse 11 says, do not respect evil. He said, let him turn away from evil and do good. You ought to treat sin like it's COVID-19, that like a disease. You can't let evil even crack the door, because it doesn't work like that. It wants your whole life. It don't want just part of your heart. It wants all of your heart. And Satan will, if he can ever get in, just crack the door. Just let him in a little bit. Now, someone said, sin is fun. And you know what? It is. Even the Bible doesn't deny it. the pleasure of sin, it said. But watch this. The pleasures of sin for a season. It don't last. Sin may be a momentary pleasure, but it is not a road to happiness, people. It will always lead you to that dead-end street, to that hog pen somewhere. And it will absolutely destroy your life. So will those that do evil, do we have to repay them? The answer is no. That belongs to God. Earlier in 1 Peter in chapter 2 and verse 21, this is what Peter said about the Master. Christ also suffered for you, leaving for you an example that you should follow in his steps, who committed no sin, neither was there deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but kept entrusting himself to him who judges righteously. In other words, Jesus just said, Father, you take care of it. Jesus didn't respect evil. He didn't repeat evil. He didn't repay evil. And that's what Paul says in Romans chapter 12 and verse 19. He says, vengeance is mine, and I will repay, saith the Lord. So when we try to take vengeance on others, we actually are stealing something that belongs to God. Vengeance is not ours. It belongs to God. But then finally this morning, Peter said, if you want to love life and see good days, you need to communicate your faith. You need to live your faith every day. Our faith cannot just be like Sunday go-to-meeting clothes that you hang up in the closet and then take out on Sunday and put on, and then as soon as church is over, you hang them back up. Our faith, a dedicated faith to God, is a faith that's 24/7. It's a faith that's lived in our lives. I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. Absolutely. Faith has to be communicated. Faith has to be seen. And so in verse 13, Peter says, and who is there to harm you if you prove, watch this, zealous. Zealous for what is good. That word zealous means be excited, to be on fire. And that's the way our faith needs to be. It needs to be a faith that's powerful. Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. He walked the walk and talked the talk, and that's what we've got to do. And Peter said, it's a key, people. It's a key to loving life and seeing good days, even whenever your world is coming down on top of you. You know, Jesus is never so near, never so close to us as whenever we are struggling with tough times. And some of you have got some pretty heavy wagons right now. They're loaded down. I know that. You're certainly in our prayers. Our hearts go out. I don't have an answer. I don't know how many times in these years that I've preached, people have asked me, why? Why, preacher? Why did this happen? Why did my loved one, I lose this loved one? Why did I get this disease? Why? I don't know. I wish I did. But that's a God thing. That's way, way above. I know even Jesus asked why. In the garden when his soul was so pressed, you remember he said, why have you forsaken me? My God, why have you forsaken me? And so even the master himself, in those moments of that are so critical in his life, asked why. But I do know this. When Paul said, there are so many things in my life, and he prayed to God, please, God, take this thorn from my flesh. He asked him three times. You remember what the answer was? I'll not take away your thorn, but I'll give you more grace. My grace is sufficient for you. And that's what we have to learn to accept. And that's the only way. Listen to me. That is the only way that you're going to be able to make any sense out of this world. Because this world's not fair. It's confusing. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't add up. The only answer is Jesus. The only answer is God's way. And that's what Peter is trying to tell us here. He said, but even if you should suffer, verse 14, for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed, and do not fear their intimidation, and do not be troubled. Boy, that's going to take some faith. But you know what? It will lead you to love life and see good days. And then Peter ends his thoughts in verse 15 by saying, but sanctify Christ the Lord in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks you the reason for the hope that's within you. And we have that hope in Jesus Christ our Lord. Well, we thank you so much today for being a part of our program. If you need anything, if there's any way we can help you with your relationships with God, give us that opportunity to do that. I hope that you had a very happy and safe 4th of July. Happy birthday to our country. And may God bless you. And may God bless America.
Good morning. If you were with us last week, you may have had, like I noticed, some mistakes in our video, and we apologize for that. But you know, maybe we had some technical problems. That's just part of what we're doing. But we had the same song twice. I'm sure you realize that we sang "Victory in Jesus" twice. My three-year-old Abby, she points that out to me later that day. She says, "Hey, Dad," she's rubbing it in, "do you know the song Victory in Jesus?" My three-year-old knows the song. She starts singing it and just rubbing it in that I had it in there twice. But we all make mistakes. We all are people who are full of mistakes. We're imperfect, and we're going to be. And that's the beauty of this meal. But it's not just about our mistakes. It's about our intentional sin, the ones that we choose against a perfect God. Last week we talked about China for a minute, and another time I remember being in China in the early part of our time there. There was four of us, four Americans, and we had a disagreement. And there was it was a Sunday, and we needed to share this meal together in worship. And I remember the meal, but I remember it was preceded by forgiveness, and then preceded with a meal that we shared together. And this is how God works as well. He's not just saying, "I want to forgive you." He says, "I want to not just forgive you, I want to fellowship with you. I want to share a meal with you." And we may not understand that about God, but He wants fellowship with us. And this meal that we're about to partake in together is not just a reminder of our forgiveness. It's a reminder of God's intent for a relationship with Him, that He wants to sit down at the table with us. And He still wants to eat with us, despite what we've done. And He gives us a way through the cross to be forgiven, and He gives us a way to be in His presence. And this is what a relationship with God looks like. It's not perfection on our part, it never will be. It's not about we can perfectly follow all the things God's asked us to, because we can't, and we can try. But it is about seeing God's perfect love poured out on us over and over again. And our mistakes, we need to talk about them. And even our intentional sin, we need to admit them. Because they speak about the power of God. They speak about the love of God, the grace of God. And as my three-year-old reminds me, they speak about victory in Jesus that overcomes the world. And it is telling that we have this victory through Christ, through the cross. It's what we remember this morning together. If you're reading with us, we're in Romans chapter 5. We just finished reading Romans 5, but I want to read to you what he says. In verse 5, he says, "For while we were still weak, and at the right time Christ died for the ungodly, for one will scarcely die for a righteous person, even though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God, showing his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have had now been justified by his blood, much more will be saved by him from the wrath of God. For while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. Much more now than we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation." What a beautiful picture that God paints for us about what he wants and who he is. And we remember that sacrifice given for us this morning. Let's pray. God, we thank you and are awe at the forgiveness that you've given us for our mistakes and our intentional sins that we've had against you, Father, and against others. And help us to make that right between us and you. We thank you for the path that you've given us for reconciliation. We thank you for the way that you've forgiven us. And not just that, but want to share the table with us, to have this relationship with us. Father, we need to know how that works. And we thank you for giving us a way to be invited into that with you. Thank you so much for the body of your son that was given on the cross. We ask that you be with us as we remember that this morning together. It's your son's name we pray. Amen. Pray with me again. Dear God, again, we thank you for what you've done for us. We thank you for coming to earth in the flesh and, Father, living among us, showing us how much you care and how much we're worth to you. Father, we thank you for your perfect sacrifice to cover our sins, the ones in the past, the ones in the present, and the ones to come. Father, we know that this is something we can never repay, and we live in that grace. We thank you for all we have through your Son. To his name we pray. Amen. We also take the time each week to pray for our offering, and we thank you for continuing to give in the ways that you have. And we know, as Virgil mentioned, all the work that's going on, you have a part of that, and we ask you continue to do that, and we continue to help those that we find in need around us, both here and around the world. So thank you for that, and continue to do that online, or you can do that through the church here at the building physically. But let's take a moment and pray. Dear God, we thank you so much for the offering that's been given through the lives of those here. Father, not just the money that's given, Father, but the time and the talent and the hearts that are poured out in your service and in your kingdom and for your glory, Father, we just thank you for that. Help us as we be people who are generous with who we are and the ways that we're able to help those around us in so many ways that you bless us with the ability to do. With our words, with our actions, with our talents, with our money. Father, we just ask that you help us become all yours. It's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we're just thankful we're here today. We're thankful for the technology we have that allows us to watch the service, be able to do the things, some of the things that we normally do. We're just thankful for those that take care of us. We know this is takes several hours and maybe even a couple of days to get all this put together. And for Jeremy and for Larry and I think Adam Rowe, we're just thankful for him. He's helping us with this, and we ask you to be with us as we go through this week, and help us to be safe, help those that has the virus to return to their normal life. And we know that it's a problem throughout this country, and especially right here in Northwest Arkansas, and we just ask you to be with us. Help us as we can recover from these illnesses, this virus, and be with us. Help us to be the examples we should be, that those that we're round about each day and live the life that's well-pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.